Hello, grads. We are time travelers. We always travel together from the future to answer one question on everyone's mind: how to predict the future. Unless you are time travelers like us, the future can be unknown, mystical, and obscure in a way. But thinking about it is very important in order to prepare for it and potentially shape it. For instance, think of 1961, when President Kennedy launched the Moonshot Challenge to put one man on the moon before the end of the decade. He did not live to see it, but a short 8 years later, 500 million people were watching how the first man, Neil Armstrong, took that small first step. Or, of all the predictions that Stanley Kubrick made in his masterpiece, 2001 Space Odyssey, there was one that actually came true. And it was not the lunar bases, the lunar colonies, neither the stewardesses that were levitating in space, but the tablets used by the astronauts, which I see many of you have also here today. Throughout our history, there have been many prophets, right? And one of the most prominent ones were probably Nostradamus, that you all know. He predicted the French Revolution, the two world wars, and even 9/11. But he was not the only one who made some lucky guesses about the future. Today, everyone from science fiction writers to billionaire tech gurus to animated sitcoms try to tell us what the future holds. And sometimes they actually get it quite right. Despite this, we think that the world of future predictions is broken. And here is why. Predictions of the future have preoccupied humans throughout history. Just think of emperors and kings who surrounded themselves with astrologers and future sayers, or the commoners who were reading their horoscopes on a daily basis. In modern times, it's not much different, right? Future predictions preoccupy individuals, all of you, but not only you. Large corporations are also very interested in the future, and so do governments. Unfortunately, throughout the human history, these future predictions have been monopolized by a narrow set of experts. This is a major shortcoming, obviously, because no one single expert can foresee the future, right? These selected experts have diluted their predictions with personal bias. Our economies and societies are fairly complex. Hence, there's no single person who can predict the whole future. They cannot grasp all the probabilities and possibilities that the future may hold. Hence, we need a new type of future forecasting to emerge. And yes, we can predict the future together. No one person can predict what the future may hold at its entirety, but we can all see snippets. And more inclusion and participation is needed, crowdsourcing predictions and then piecing them together. Today, we have very rigorous forecasting techniques, foresight techniques available at our disposal, which can be used to teach university students, like medical university grads, in all disciplines to complement their vertical subject matter knowledge with horizontal understanding of the complex world surrounding them. That's how simple it is. Voila.
But I don't think so. Goalkeepers have got a 33% more chance to save penalties if only they learned to stay at the center. However, almost 100% of them jump to either the left or the right. Futurists and future scientists suffer from a similar kind of omission bias. They think that their profession is not worthwhile unless they come up with something stupendous, something miraculous. So if we were to live in a world which has been predicted by these future scientists, we would now be living in a world full of those flying cars, miracle pills, spaghetti protein included, and square tomatoes. However, if you really think about the future is actually nothing but a factor of the past and the present. If you really think about it, it is just a compounding of the history of the past and the present, the current world which we live in. So we don't really need to be biased by those personal biases of the astrologers, the soothsayers, the fortune tellers, nor do we need to be biased by the omission bias of the futurists and the future scientists. All what we probably need to do is to look at those undercurrents, the underlying trends. And if we were to look at those undercurrents, we would be able to come up with a reliable prediction model of the future, which is quite reliable enough for us, statistically, scientifically. For example, the interconnections between jobs and learning. Always the purpose of learning has been to prepare the youngsters, majority of you sitting over here, to prepare you for a future job which you would be doing. So when we were hunter-gatherers, several thousands of years back, there were only two purposes as far as a youngster was concerned when he grew up. One, saving himself from that saber-toothed tiger. Second, to hunt down the fleshiest of the wild boar. So at that point of time, learning was more about fun. There was no difference between fun and work. Learning was more about exploratory. It was skill intensive rather than labor intensive or time intensive. But the minute we settled down in our farms as agrarians, part of it, it was a watershed moment as far as jobs was concerned, as far as learning was concerned. Learning became labor intensive, learning became time intensive. And in the post-industrial era, the work shifted from those beautiful serene farms over to the crowded cities. Our workplaces shifted from the secluded farms which we managed into the sweaty, grimy factories. And the work culture, it became vertical, it became hierarchical. It was led by the clock, and it was repetitive. And the learning which you end up going through currently, again, repetitive, regimentalized, compartmentalized, and most importantly, kids are stacked into those benches facing front to the teacher as if you're getting ready for an assembly line. And now when you step into the digital world and to the world of micro corporations, the micro corporations are those small, nimble, flat, near zero employees, access to immense resources, back to those beautiful valleys of the world and the beautiful beaches of the world where we would be working, our learning would change again. Learning again would become flat, horizontal. You would learn from your peers than from a teacher. Most importantly, your learning would become hyper-personalized. Just like that magical TikTok or the Instagram Reels, which shows you exactly what you need to see at this particular moment of time, the future learning will help you learn what exactly you need at this particular moment of time. Future need not be a black box. If you look at the undercurrents, if you look at the underlying trends, whether it is healthcare, whether it is geopolitics, whether it is climate change, whether it is consumption, all these things can be linked together. And almost 95% of your future would be predictable. That's it.
Are you sure? I don't think so. Well, what you mentioned could predict 95% of the future event that could be a result of interconnections. But the remaining 5%, black swan events, could have much larger bearing on our world that could disrupt our future. Our question is, so how to predict these 5% and not leaving them to surprise us? For this, we three time travelers want to share with you a method called crowdsourcing of our future. The crowdsourcing our future, we do like three things. The first, we ask those 100 experts to try it and predict based on the data and their experience. So our short-term future, let's say 5 years, then medium-term future, approximately 10 years, and then the long-term future, it's 30 years and beyond. So instead of making blind quantum jump, experts make data-based small jumps based on their experience. Second, we create a future index based on the scenarios and predictions given by these several experts. We create a data collection method and put it out in the audience. And this index is recalibrated in our time every year. Third, we set up future centers across the world where we simulate these scenarios and generate wider discussions. And experts from across domains gather there to share these ideas and to discuss. Now, let us to give you only a peek into the future, as we are not allowed to say too much to not disturb the time-space continuum. So as we are in the medical university, I will start with medicine. So the future of medicine and healthcare will be about how to prevent illness from occurring, not about how to cure the disease. In the future, we will be able to heal wounds in minutes, grow full-fledged organs, bones, cells, and so on. And we will be able to repair damaged brains, which is particularly for me very important because I am a recovered patient of a brain surgery. So health will be the predominant. So in the future, not the virus, but the health will be contagious. Let's talk about our homes. As woman, for me, the most important part in the house is the bathroom. My bathroom has augmented reality simulation. My bath has such a solid, relaxing, and healing effect on my entire body that your current shower seemed like child's play from the past. But more importantly, my bathroom function is not wash away the dirt, but remove the psychological stress that I have accumulating during the whole day and gain a new vitality. So, in conclusion, you might wish to know how best to prepare and thrive in the future. Here is some very quick advice for you. Follow your passion. Scale and share great ideas. Do new things every day. Don't be afraid of new and unknown things, and get acquainted with your own future. Practice mindfulness, presence, and being kind. Especially kindness is the most requested and highest valued skill in the future. Responsible leaders should remain ethical and only use their talents for good, like ours doing. One more small piece of advice before we travel back to our home. Don't ask your children what they want to be, but what problem in this world they want to solve.